morning, church. Welcome to the Church of the Savior. So even though it may be humid, cloudy, and rainy, but let's rejoice. It's a day that God has made for us. And we know any day that God has made is a blessed day for us. And the biggest blessing is that we all are here today, alive and well. So let's praise and worship God today. So if you have joined us in person, may God bless you. And if you've joined us via Facebook, may God bless you. And if you're going to see our recording later, may God bless you as well. I welcome you all to our service today for next around an hour. Let's come together and worship God. If you don't know me, my name is Sujoy Nandi, and I'm a member of this church, and today I have the privilege of worship leading the service. And as also I would like to introduce Thomas, he'll be leading us in our songs, and Colin will be guiding us on music, on the rhythm. If you're visiting our church for the first time, you're welcome. We hope that God will touch your heart today, and you will feel His presence in your life. After the service, we would like to invite you to join us for a cup of coffee with us. It will be a pleasure to speak to you and find out a little bit more about you. If you wish to offer your Thanksgiving, the offertory boxes at the back, you know, we don't have the culture of that bag going around, the offertory bag going around now. So if you wish to offer your tithings, feel free to drop it in that box. The church will be very grateful to you, and of course we pray that God will bless your tithing. Now Psalm 95:6 says, "O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker." So let us come together and worship Him today. Now we are in a season of Advent, and today is the third Sunday in Advent. This year we are using the Advent liturgy from generation to generation by sanctified art. And as we continue to do so, I would like to invite the Duncan family to the front, Trish, Barry, Haley's, and Dupree. Please come and share with us responses from over 100 people, ranging from the ages of 2 to 8. When they were asked that question, "What brings you joy?" So from the voices of different generations of Duncan family, please hear the answers that people gave to that question. Is it on?
Sand between my toes.
Being outside.
Sleeping in my own bed after a night away.
Having a camera in my hands.
My partner's night life. Come on.
Mountain air.
When my parents pick me up.
The end of my to-do list.
Hugs from my niece and nephew.
Baby giggles.
My dog.
Putting my hands in the garden.
A cord resolved.
What is a cord, dear?
Baby stargazing.
Bedtime stories.
A warm cup of coffee with friends.
My new granddaughter.
Staying at the table after dinner.
Time with my family.
Today we gather we light the candle of joy. May its light remind us of all the good news this season brings. May it light remind us of the many sources of joy in our lives. And may that joy not only draw us closer to one another, but closer to God.
Thank you, Haley.
Family of faith, what brings you joy?
Well, thank you, Duncan family. That is a very important question. What brings you joy? Especially during this time of Advent, as we move into the season of Christmas. And as we continue to deliberate on that question and the topic of Advent, our theme for today is what we can choose a better way. I'll repeat that. We can choose a better way. So soon we will all come together to read from the scriptures, and then we will listen to Shashi as he preaches on this topic. But before that, let us greet each other in the name of Christ. And as we do that, let's continue to follow our COVID rules and just guide and guard ourselves from this very deadly virus. So you can get up and walk around and meet your friends and colleagues.
Let's gather back to our seats as we sing our worship song.
Thank you.
Father, by your grace, so I'm free.
We exalt you, our God, the King. We will praise your name forever and ever. Every day we will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will command your works to another. They will tell of your mighty acts. So as we continue to praise our Lord, let us come together and offer him our praise. Now today our format for prayers is a little bit different. How it will work is, before we go into our intercessory prayers, using the generation-to-generation liturgy, we will together proclaim affirmation of faith, which will come up on the screen. After that, I will say a shortened prayer from the liturgy, and then we will move into time of silence and intercessory prayers. Finally, we will end the section of prayers with the Lord's Prayer, which will come up on the screen. So let us first start with proclaiming loudly affirmation of our faith in God and Lord Jesus Christ. We believe in a God who offers second chances and does not hold grudges. We believe in a God who opens the door to new life and leaves the porch light on us when we get lost. We believe in a God who believes in us, believes that we can make a difference, that we can choose grace over comparison, love over hate, peace over war. We believe. Let us offer our intercessory prayers for those around us and ourselves, especially during this time, for those we know that feel alone at Christmas, for those we know for whom Christmas is a sad time, or for anyone God is putting in your heart to pray for today. You can pray in your silence. Or if God is putting it in your heart to pray loudly, please feel free to do so. Thank you. Amen. And in our striving to choose a better way, God, may we be transformed. May the story of Joseph rattle something loose in us. May the story of Joseph help us drop the need to be right, or to be the best, or to have it all figured out. And instead, may draw us closer to authenticity and you. May the story of imperfection sew grace into our bones. May we catch glimpses of your love in our world. May we shake off the dust of our old selves and live into something new. And may we be a little more like Joseph, but mainly may we be a little more like you. And with that hope in our heart, please join me in Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not bring us to the test, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, it's time for questions of the day. And as usual, there are two questions today. Let us do them one at a time. And the questions will come up on the screen. The first one is, what do you like, sweet or savory treats this Christmas? Is that the same thing you would have chosen as a child? So what do you like, a sweet treat or a savory treat over this Christmas? And is that a choice that you would have made as a child as well? So let's go into groups of 3 to 5 and share our answers. Samosas. So would anyone like to share their answers? Is there anyone who would like to share their answers?
Savory, salmon and cheese.
Savory and salmon and cheese.
Louisa's a sweet treat as a child,
given to Louisa. Yeah. Great. Sweet savory. Well, Shashi said he likes samosas.
Yeah, I didn't say that. Because I love sweet. I don't want to say that.
Mince pies. Okay. Very dangerous. Yeah. Well, let's go to our second question now. And second question is the most important question of the day, which Duncan family shared some answers for. What brings you joy? What brings you joy? So again, in group of 3 to 5, have some conversation and share what brings you joy. Right. Would anyone like to share their answers? What brings you joy? Anyone?
Music.
Music brings joy to Thomas. Family time. Yes. The Lord has come. That brings you joy. Holidays. Yeah. Holidays bring joy. Well, to me, when my wife is happy, I find joy. Such joy. Well, it's time for our scripture readings now. And today we are reading from Matthew 1:18-25 and Isaiah 35:1-10. So it's a church practice. Let's come together to read one verse each loudly. You can read it from your Bible or you can read it from the screen up there. So let's go for it.
This is the birth of Jesus, the Messiah of kingdom. His mother Mary and Joseph had promised to be married. But before they started to live together, it became clear that she was going to have a baby. Pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to us. So as I mentioned earlier, during the season of Advent, as we continue to focus on generation to generations by sanctified art, our topic for today is, we can choose a better way. So as we listen to Shashi, let's focus our minds and heart on how we can choose a better way in our lives like Joseph did when he followed Isaiah's prophecy. Over to you, Shashi. Let's pray for Shashi. Father God, I pray for Shashi as he speaks to us today, oh Father, on this topic of how we can choose a better way. May your word speak to us, may it touch our hearts, and may we look at our lives and see what areas need to be transformed, oh Father. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Sir John. Yes, we've been reminded that we're continuing our from generation to generation, and this is the third week of it, and so it is an amazing journey so far. We've been looking at life of Mary, we have looked at, and we have looked at stories from Isaiah, how God has promised, and Isaiah 2 was kind of a significant passage where it says that the people of the Lord will come to the mountain, and those weapons of war will be turned into the gardening tools. And so now we come today, to this Sunday, looking at how we can choose a better way as we look forward of generation to generations. We thank God that we are here because previous generation and people invested. And so we will continue to invest our lives so that the next generation will continue to walk in faith. So imagine with me. Imagine with me Lucy and Linus. Peanut cartoons, if you are familiar with this. Are you? Yeah, you must be, because it is the Western story. So I hope you know that. Lucy asks Linus, why do you suppose people are here anyway? Have you read this before? No? So Linus answers, someone said that every person is on earth to make someone else happy. Then Lucy pondered for a moment and then screams out, well, somebody is not doing their job. Well, given the reports of TV and newspapers and all that, if you read today, we find Lucy is not alone in feeling let down, isn't it? In our politically correct world, society, people are still being marginalized and being isolated from food, shelter, power, and hope. The working poor, the single parents on welfare, the homeless, the street kid, the mentally ill, the family of an alcoholic, the child going back and forth between separated parents, the refugees, the list goes on and on and on in our society today. We live in a society that increasingly divides people into haves and have-nots. Such a division breaks apart whatever sense of community exists among people. It builds walls of misunderstanding that leads to isolation, not just for those with problems, but everyone isolates themselves in cocoons of self-protection. So such divisions occur in society. They can occur in the church too. It can take place within our church. And so here we today, we look at first Isaiah 35. Isaiah 35 reminds us that in midst of all this society, which is so divided, so marginalized, where there is no hope, Isaiah 35, 1 to 10 reminds us that the power of God power of God to transform the harshest reality and settings and bring joy that is deep and lasting. Where there is so dry, there can be a hope of a new growth. It's an amazing, impossible picture as you read Isaiah. Dry ground will blossom. You've been to a desert? Have you been to the Middle East or to the Saharan desert? Or in New Zealand, it's very hard to imagine the desert because we have a desert road, but it is full of life. There is nothing a desert about it. I mean, when we came to New Zealand, when first time in 2003, I went to the conference in Taupo and I was told about the desert road. And I said, wow, there'll be a desert in the middle of New Zealand. And I was a bit shocked to find that there was nothing like desert, because I have seen the desert far drier than that. Well, here we have Isaiah seeing a vision of the wondrous power of God to bring life where there is nothingness and joy where there is hopelessness. In his vision, the desert was brought to bloom and the wilderness became a paradise. When we choose a better way, it has an impact from one generation to the next generation, including for eternity. The result is an overwhelming joy because the Lord can and will do such amazing things for those whom God loves. As we read the first two verses, the desert and the parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom. It will burst into bloom. It will rejoice greatly and shout for joy. The glory of the Lebanon will be given to it. The splendor of Carmel and Sharon, and they will see the glory of the Lord and the splendor of our God. Here is God's power. God's power to transform impossible situations. God's power to offer us hope. God's power to bring joy. Isaiah pictures for us that with the power of God, things are possible. God can turn impossibilities into the possibilities. Now, that was the question, or that was the statement we read last week as angels spoke to Mary, saying that nothing is impossible for God. And today we are reminded from Isaiah, with the power of God, there is a possibility, and there is possibility. And it has been proven over these 2,000 years that God is a God of transformation. God is a God of hope, and God is the one who brings joy. That's the power that Isaiah saw and proclaimed. It is the power that transformed the Son of God into a helpless babe. A God of creation transformed into a helpless, vulnerable baby. That is what we celebrate in the Christmas. It is a power that transforms simple, uneducated men and women into disciples who first followed Jesus and then led the vast number of people to follow Jesus. It was so funny of Jesus, isn't it? It's so crazy of God not to select educated people who had given the years and hours of study in a Jewish law, not to choose them, but to go to the seaside and choose the lowest kind of people, uneducated people, who were not accepted by society. Choose Peter, John, James, who had no value in the society, and invite them to follow. They follow and they become the transforming power of God into the society. And that's why you and I are sitting here. Not because those who were holding the PhDs, but those who were willing to work hard. God lifted who were nobodies so that we can become somebody. It is a power that transformed the instruments of torture and death, the cross, into a throne of the one who conquered sin and death. It is a power that transformed the frightened group of believers who thought they had lost their leader into the most dynamic, faithful religious force the world has ever seen. It is a power that transformed the brokenness of people with the pain and problems into people who know that no matter what they face, they are not alone. God is with you. God is with us, no matter what happens to us. And I encourage you to look out for some of this artwork which is being displayed in a foyer by the Sanctified Art Ministries. And this week's image, if you have used our devotional booklet, you would see for today that this week's image is done by artist Reverend Lorraine Pittman. And Lorraine Pittman has done this, and the devotional where she sees, or this person sees this Isaiah 35 from the kind of a point of view of a kaleidoscope and seeing that how it blossoms. I encourage you to read. We have put out the, you know, A3 size papers there for you to read information as well as take the devotional booklet and read it. In this image, Lorraine chose a few of the many vivid visuals from the text and created a kaleidoscope of shots. Starting in the center, crocuses blooming and weak hands are strengthened, eyes are open, bodies leap with joy, a burning sand become a pool, swamp are formed, and the light of gladness radiates from the entire composition. We need prophecies like this. We need prophecies like in our midst today, that there is a hope, there is a joy. God will bring gladness. There are certainly seasons of disappointment, devastation and grief in this life, but we need to make our homes there. We could choose to shy away from such optimism during the particular difficult times, while getting endlessly lost and settled into the apathy and despair. Or we could choose a better way and hold fast to the stories of joy that is to come. There is a way back from those who feel in exile. Don't give up. There is a hope. There is a community of those who feel isolated. There is an oasis of for those who are wandering in the wilderness. There is a hope for those who feel squeezed out in the margins of society. There is hope in choosing a better way, the way of the Lord. And this is something I've learned in life over these years, walking and doing ministry in Jesus' name. That when God is about to do something great, He starts with difficulty. When God is about to do something great, He starts with difficulty. And when He's about to do something truly magnificent or magnificent, He starts with an impossibility. It was impossible for a virgin to give birth without having relationship with other human. It was impossible for Elizabeth to conceive when they had passed the age. It was impossible. Biologically, humanly, it is impossible. But God did something great, magnificent work by equipping them. And so we are continuing the story today. I know we faced lots of impossible situations in our lives, lots of difficulties in life. But maybe those are the opportunities for us to trust the Lord. Those are the opportunity for us to trust God that He will bring forth. Sometimes it doesn't look any way forward. It can frustrate us, it can anger us, it can bust us into all kinds of language which we sometimes humanly don't want to speak in others' presence. God can take all that and still He can bring joy to us. He has His time. God spoke 700 years before Christ was born. A promise that virgin will bear a child. He will be Prince of Peace. It took 700 years, including a silence years, when there was no prophecy. If God can do that, fulfill, after 700 years and now after 2,000 years for us, here, today, on this day, enable us to celebrate His birthday. Man, we are to trust this God who has been faithful through generation to generation. And well, that is the example which we have here, example of Mr. Joseph. Mr. Joseph's example is a crazy example, isn't it, for us. Mary and Joseph, we know that they have been in a marriage contract or they've been engaged, let's put it in our language. And then Mary says that I've heard some news about my cousin Elizabeth. I want to go and see her. And Joseph says, oh, well, that's good. It's a few kilometers away. Go to Hamilton and come back. And then she drives off. And she does not return for almost 3-4 months. And Joseph has not seen her. And after 4 months, when Mary comes back, she's not able to sit into the driver's seat because she's got a big tummy. And Joseph said, what on earth? What have you done? You are no worthy to be my wife anymore. I sent you to visit your cousin Elizabeth. And now you have come back with a big tummy. What is this? Not acceptable. What would you do? You've been engaged, and your partner, that engaged partner, goes away for a few months and come back with a weird story. Will you believe? Will you say, yeah, yeah, all fine, God has blessed you? Joseph had the same dilemma like us, any normal human dilemma. And here you find Joseph not willing to publicly disgrace or humiliate her. He has all sorted out plan. And then God does a crazy thing. God sends the message through the dream. Angel coming and speaking, saying, do not be afraid. Take heart. And still struggling. It is impossible, isn't it? It's a very difficult situation. And Joseph is invited to trust God. When have our ancestors also chosen a better way? When they have not. When have you chosen a better way to trust the story of God? And when have you not? You know, Reverend Darrell Hamilton has contemplated on Joseph's experience of becoming a parent of Jesus. And he has written in one of the Baptist magazines, saying that not by DNA, but mutual affection and interdependence is a father eternally bound to his children and vice versa. Even though Mary was chosen to be the God-bearer, Joseph was commanded to be the God-rearer. You know, Mary bore God and gave birth. But Joseph was invited to raise up this God child. What an amazing responsibility and privilege. And here, you know, it's one of the greatest example of discipleship. Some of us are very good evangelists. We can go talk the story of God and people believe, and we give birth through them in the kingdom of God. But there are others who are needed, like Joseph, who should rear those newborn people into faith and becoming disciples of God. Joseph is an important link for us. Joseph is an important link for us of generations of faith and obedience. You know, we learn 700 years before Joseph, this promise was given, and Joseph becomes an important link for us because today we have that story of Jesus, because Joseph trusted what God was saying. And this is one thing, like if you have read into the seventh or the seven generation principles, if you have read into that aspect, especially that is coming out from the first people of North America, so-called Red Indians or those stories. And in this seven generation principles, it is important that you identify where you are. You are here today because of, in your family, of the previous generation, which kind of impacted the stories and life. So you have now come now into these generations, you holding those precious stories, and now you're going to impact into the next generations. Sometimes some of you are blessed with children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. So you are already being impacting next 3 to 4 generations. So what stories you inherited and what stories you passing on? Kind of, you know, past 3 generations, you are in the middle and you're passing on to the next 3 generations. Once we situate ourselves within this wider chain of those before us and those to come, we can begin to see how our purpose and belonging is built within the fact of our existence. It is so important. You are an important link in the God story. You are sitting here and worshiping here because someone, either in your family or someone in your circle, passed on that story. And that's why you are here. So how that chain going to continue? Will that chain stop or break with you? Or will it continue passing on to the next? We have inherited the consequences of the decision of those before us. And we will pass on the consequences of our own decisions today. So in the past, someone made a decision of passing on faith to you. If you do not pass on, it is your decision to stop that faith with you. Choice is in our hand, as Joseph had a choice in his hand. Joseph would have believed or not believed that story. And we would have been quite a different story. So we learn from Joseph that to choose a better way means we must have the courage to be mocked by the world. He was willing to be ashamed. He was willing to be mocked by the world. Imagine in the society, people must have been telling the stories. I'm not sure how in New Zealand it works, but I've come from the rural India. Anything, little thing happens in one family, entire village knows within a day. So Joseph had a very tough time, but he was willing to be mocked. We need to have the courage to let Jesus be in charge of our life. That's what Joseph did. Let God be in charge. And we need a courage to obey God's word. We need to obey God's word. Imagine if Joseph would not have obeyed God, no Christmas, no Easter, no life after death, no accountability beyond our justice system, no balancing of injustices of life, no sense that there is a power above us seeking to bring us good, no understanding that life has been created from beyond ourselves, no sense of life as something with meaning and purpose to be discovered, no community of love and care to rest in and serve with. We will not have this Church of the Savior. And I would not have come here, because there would have been no story of Jesus. I would be still worshiping Krishna. But because of Jesus, we are here together, because that story kept on passing on. You know, that has brought us the joy. We are here together because joy to the world that the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing because the Lord has come. So in closing, friends, there is this Yellowstone thing in U.S. If you have seen the 2012 movie, it talks about in that, in that the Yellowstone, where there is a great, what you call, heritage park is there. And they're carrying out something important of that, what you call, inheritance pass. And this is something very interesting story I read. I have never been to this place. But is that they've been driving this campaign to preserve Yellowstone National Park, and they're launching this year in 2022 in March to celebrate that 150 years, and they're selling for $1,500 donation pass, so that people can buy this inheritance pass, so that in 150 years' time, that is, I think, 2,172, in 150 years' time, if you pass on this inheritance pass, your family or your person can have the free access in next 150 years to the Yellowstone. That is what they're doing today. This initiative emphasizes that the importance of preservation, both now and for the future generations. And this is a very important faith lens for us. What choices can we make now that will impact the faith of those who come 150 years after us? Next year, Church of the Savior will celebrate 125 years. Somebody planted a seed in 1893 here. What seed you and I will leave, so that in 125 years, if Jesus has not returned, there will be a community continuing to worship here. Just don't think about today. Have the longer view. If you have very good neighbors who are sharing with you precious goodies every year, would you like them to be joining with you for eternity or not? What inheritance will we pass on? God was with us. God was with Church of the Savior when it became as the Chapel of the Good Shepherd 125 years back. God is with us today when we have become Church of the Savior here. And do you imagine God will be with our people worshiping in this place next 125 years? Think of it. Pray for it. And invest in that. I'm not asking you $1,500. I'm asking your faith story. That seed to be invested so that next generation, from this generation to the next generation, faith continues to abound. Amen.
Thank you, Sergi. There's lots to take on from that sermon, and I felt quite challenged. Not sure about you guys. Yes, what are we going to leave behind? Inheritance in our legacy to our next generation. Very important question. So let's all join together in worshiping as Thomas is going to lead. So let's all stand up, please. And as we worship the Lord, let's also prepare for the communion.
So this is a new song today. So if you don't recognize it, then you're just welcome just to close your eyes, listen to the lyrics, but the words will be on the screen, of course.
The prayer of confession is an opportunity to slow down. We take that tenth of a second and give it a room to breathe. I invite you to, together, we reflect on the decisions that we have made this past week, and we ask for God's mercy to be in all of them. Let us go to God in prayer as we share our confession. The words are on the screen. God of mercy, a million of times a day, we have the opportunity to be gracious, to assume the best in others, to give the benefit of the doubt. A million times a day we could choose the better way, but so often we don't. Fear and greed kick in. Assumptions and insecurities take the wheel. Comparison and critic lead the way. Forgive us for forgetting that we are descendants of Joseph. Forgive us for forgetting that grace and mercy are in our blood. Forgive us for forgetting that all belong to you. Give us the courage to love even bigger than before, and the wisdom to choose a better way. Amen. So friends, hear the Church of the Savior. Hear this good news. We who have chosen wrong are given a second chance. We who have lost our way are welcome into the community. We who feel alone are seen, held, and known. And this is the good news of the gospel for all of us. No matter how many times we choose wrong or lose our way, God continues to be a God of second chances. He invites us into community and He offers us His love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so, Lord, we thank You that You have offered us that gift of love. As You offered to Joseph, You offer to us in the person of Jesus Christ. We thank You for His life, His death and resurrection, and His ascension and blessed hope of His return. And as He taught us, before He died on that night, He gave us this institution where He took bread, and when He had given You thanks, He broke it and gave it to His disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is My body, which is given for you. Do this to remember Me." And after supper, He took the cup. When He had given thanks to you, He gave it to His disciples and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is My blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, to remember Me." So we come this day remembering this story of Jesus. Let's invite Jesus afresh as we come to the table and meet Him afresh as we break the bread and share in the cup, that may truly be inspired by His Spirit to be His people in this world today. So come, God's people, to receive and partake into the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ. Come to the table to remember, to surrender, and to obey. With the help of the Holy Spirit, obey the words of Jesus to be His people in this world. So friends, draw near and receive the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ. In remembrance that He died for us, let us feed on Him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Those of you assisting, please come forward. Thank you. As you come forward, you can sanitize your hand and come and stand and receive the communion.
You have a long road behind. can't sleep tonight. Go to sleep, my son. Go and chase your dreams. This world.
Father, we thank you for bringing us together today to worship you and to give you thanks. We thank you for Joseph's example for us and the promise of your gracious growth and hope in midst of all impossibilities. So Lord, as we go from this house, from this place, into the world, into our places of comfort, may we hear these words as we go from here, that from generation to generations we have been claimed and loved. From generation to generation God has been our side. From generation to generation we are not alone. The God of yesterday and God of tomorrow knows each of us by name. He loves us. He loves you, my friends, and He calls you forth, saying, go be the person you are called to be in this world. Because you are loved widely by God, so go and love one another. You've been served by God justly, so go and do justice. And as God invites us, let us come back to His house together as His people to worship and to glorify. And may He strengthen you, bless you, and encourage you as you go. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Some notices. Thank you.
Well, it's time for our notices. Again, a special welcome to visitors and newcomers. I hope you enjoyed the service today, and we invite you to join us in the foyer for tea and coffee after this service. There are around, I think, four notices. Thomas, someone has come to see you there. They're waiting out there. Someone has come to see you there. They just were asking for you. Now, while he's out, so I'll read this. So Thomas, his card and is out there. Please, if take time to sign it. Also, we are arranging for the gift. So if there's anyone would like to give, contribute to it, please do so. You can do it in a cash or you can transfer it to the church account, please. Do put his name. Otherwise, people will, it'll get confusing. What's the money for? I hope he comes back now. there's a sheep trail from 12 to 24 December. And the 32 businesses are taking part this year. It's a great way to support our local community. So spread the word. And if you can participate, please do so. And from generation to generation, devotion is available. That's the one that we are following for this Advent season. So she preached from that liturgy, and so it's available. The link is also in the newsletter, and it's the printed copies in the foyer. There are other links also in the newsletter, so check there. And then our blue Christmas tree. It will be outside the COTS front door for all the community to add a name decoration to remember someone or to pray for something that has been hard this year. The tree will be there from 12th to 24th December. If you know of someone in your circle who would benefit from any of these resources, please let them know. And service link and printable services are in the newsletter. That's for the notices. So the last and the most important thing to say is, go forth into the world in peace and in joy. Amen. Amen.